الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him, we seek His aid and guidance. He whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, none can lead astray. And He whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leads astray, none can guide. I bear witness and testify that there is no to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I bear witness and testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His slave and final messenger. Brothers and sisters, know that the best of words are the words of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the best of guidance is the guidance of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the worst of affairs are those newly invented in this religion, and all newly invented matter in this religion is an innovation. And all innovation is misguidance, and all misguidance leads to the hellfire. Just before we begin concerning the entrance of the month of Ramadan, we first ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He allows us to greet this month, and that we are safe and that we are well, and that He allows us to welcome this month, and the Muslim Ummah is at security, and that the Muslim Ummah is safe and healthy. The dispute amongst the ulama, as Shaykh Abdul Rahman has mentioned, is a great dispute. But this is not necessarily a bad thing for the Ummah. For when we see the dispute amongst the Muslims concerning the entrance of Ramadan, that means there is an interest for this blessed month, and that is a good thing. When we see that the Ummah are arguing with one another to what day Ramadan begins, then this is a good thing, because they are at least interested in following the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in fasting in this month, a month that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made obligatory upon us. Then this is a good thing. Yes, as a nation, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the best of guides, and he has guided us to sight the moon. And the ulama have said that the sighting of the moon is what is needed in this month. For we see it with the naked eye, because the naked eye is what was asked by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to see the moon. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had the ability very easily to say, use the technology of your era to sight the moon, and he said, if the moon was absent because of cloud or because of any other reason, then complete the month of Sha'ban. It's very easy scenario for the Muslim Ummah, yet we still fall into this dispute, and that's okay. So inshallah, we all begin Ramadan with an open heart and sincere for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether the Ummah or some or part or a few of the Ummah begin their fasting tomorrow, or whether they begin on Monday, because if it's not tomorrow, then definitely it has to be on Monday. Because tomorrow will be the 30th of Sha'ban, and Monday we have to fast whether we like it or not, whether the moon says it or not. This is how it is. But this is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the months, as Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked, Ya Rasulullah, how many months do we have? He said, we are a nation of illiterate people. The month is, and he's pointed with his hands, that it is 29 or 30. So this is simple, inshaAllah. As an ummah, if a person fasted before you, then this is not an issue. The issue is when we break our fast. So inshaAllah, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if we differ in the beginning of Ramadan, let us inshaAllah unite at the end, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that the day of fitr, the day of your breaking of the fast, is the breaking of the fast of the ummah. And the day of al-adha is the day when the people perform al-adha. So this is inshaAllah, in summary of what we should be aiming for. We should be aiming for uniting of the Ummah. Last week, alhamdulillah, we went through a lot of things concerning Ramadan. Let us today focus on the ahkam and parts of the ahkam, some of the ahkam. Yes, there are millions of questions that people might ask, because it becomes personal. So there are personal questions that you want to ask, and inshallah we'll give you enough room at the end, even though there are more knowledgeable people in this area to answer the questions, but we will do the best of our ability inshallah. Who is obliged to fast? This is the first question we ask, because we know that it is obligatory, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ, that siyam has been made obligatory upon you. Who is this? The ulama are in consensus that the person that is obliged to fast, he has to be a Muslim. He has to be a Muslim. he has to be sane, he has to be reaching the age of maturity, which is puberty, and he must be resident, and he must be fit, able, well. This isn't consensus. All of these people have to fast. There is difference of opinion concerning which is better for the sick person and the traveler. This we'll discuss later. But the consensus, if you are a resident, if you are well, if you are mature, if you are a Muslim and you are sane, then you fast the month of Ramadan. So, this is the question that we ask. What is maturity, first of all? Concerning the ulama, the maturity age, there is no specific age, but there is a cutoff. There is a cutoff. And the majority of the ulama have said about 15. The 15 years of age, if a person has not had any signs of puberty, which is hair grown on the face or the mustache in the pubic area under the arms, or wet dreams, and this is for both the male and the female, and an extra for the female is her monthly period. If any things of these happen, then that person has reached maturity, has reached puberty. So this person is obligatory upon them to fast. But the Muslim Ummah has been also taught by Muhammad ﷺ to start teaching, to start instilling the behavior of a Muslim at a very early age for our children. And so the ulama have discussed what age should a child begin to fast. And the ulama, as Abu Hanifa and some of the other scholars, have said that we should start at the same age of Salah. As Muhammad ﷺ said, teach your children, encourage your children to pray at 7, and hit them, discipline them upon it on 10. So we, with fasting, as some of the ulama have mentioned, we take the same as prayer. We instill and we encourage our children at 7 to begin to fast. Is it obligatory? No, it's not. Is it a must? No, it's not. But we instill the fasting in our children. And then when they reach 10, we not only instill this aspect of our worship, which is fasting, but we make it apparent to them that it is disliked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you break your fast. When? At 10. At the cutoff. And then at 10, usually the girls will have reached puberty at about 10 or 11. And the boys need a few more years. And some of them at 10 or 11 have reached puberty also. So this age of 10 is when we then forcefully, with our words, not with our hand, with our words, we tell them, if you do not fast, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be upset. This is a part of Islam and we must fast. So we start at 7 at a very early age. At a very early age we start instilling. We have to take lessons from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions in how we do this. We do not yell and make our children feel like they're doing something wrong if they're not fasting at 7. We said we encourage. And the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it's mentioned by Imam al-Bukhari in his book, and also mentioned by Ibn Hajar in Fath al-Bari. He said, the chapter of the fasting of the children, the young, subyan. And he mentioned the hadith where the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make a doll, make a toy for the children. And when it gets later in the day and the children begin to feel the pains of fasting and hunger and thirst, they would give them this doll to play with. Now we take from this a lesson, is that we do not do, like some of us sadly, in Ramadan everything is haram. We keep away from the children any kind of playing, any kind of toys, any kind of amusement, because we tell them this is the month of the Quran, this is the month of Salah, this is the month of fasting. And so the child feels that he is surrounded with all of these acts of worship, but there's no amusement. But the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who knew Islam more than us and practiced it more than us with more sincerity, would say that their kids, when they feel a bit hungry or a bit tired, they would give them the toy. So we follow that footstep. If your child begins to feel a little bit hungry, they're not forced to fast. We give them a little toy, we allow them to play a game, to allow them and allow time to go by so they can fast that day and inshallah receive the reward. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the glorious Quran, and that we as a Muslim and as a parent, we should instill in our children the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the hope in the rewards of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we should safeguard our families from the hellfire. And this is one aspect. With salah, we have siyam. So when this month enters, we support our family in any way that they need. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the glorious Quran, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And we said, when we mentioned that the first time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, we must listen, and listen very carefully. For this is a warning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we must do, or it is a favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us that we must listen to see what it is. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا means fear, protect. قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, your first self. Because you cannot protect others if you haven't protected yourself. And this is only logic. If you know the truth but don't practice it, how could you save others? And if you don't know the truth, how could you teach it to others? فَقَدْ الشَّيْءِ لَا يُعْطِي. The person who has not got the thing cannot give it. If you don't have money, you can't give it. You don't have food, you can't feed anybody. So if you don't have fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can't pass on to others. If you don't have knowledge in Islam, you can't pass on to others. And even in logic, even nowadays, when you go into an aeroplane, what do they tell you? If the gas masks fall, protect yourself, then your children. Put the gas mask, the oxygen mask on your face, then protect your children. Why? Because if you try to save your child by putting on the gas mask and then you faint with lack of oxygen, could you continue protecting your child? No, and all of a sudden you're dead. So you don't protect yourself, and then maybe the child also dies. So this is only logic. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you, protect yourself first. قُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا, then your family from the punishment of hell. And this is what we have to do. So yes, we instill in our children this fear and also this hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. Extra attention must be paid by the parents, especially the mother, when a girl is fasting. Because a girl, when she is fasting, and she has her periods, sometimes out of her shyness, she doesn't say that she is going through her monthly cycle out of shyness. But then she continues to fast. We should have to tell her that a person and a female with this doesn't fast, and even if she fasts, it is not accepted by her. It is not accepted by her, because God told her not to fast. As mentioned in hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, that at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that a lady, during her monthlies, would be ordered to make up her fasting, but not to make up the salah. So her fasting at that time is not accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we as a parent, as a father or a mother, we should teach our child this, especially the females, that if she is going through this, it is okay to tell her mother, so she can now eat and drink, and she has to fast after Ramadan. Now if a non-Muslim becomes Muslim during Ramadan, then they have to fast, they have to begin to fast. Do they have to make up the previous days? No, they don't. But when they become Muslim, if they became Muslim on the fifth day of Ramadan, we tell them that tomorrow is fasting, they must fast by the next day, but the days prior, the days before, they do not have to make up those days. Also with the insane person, if a person is insane, mentally unstable, and then wakes up, and then becomes saying again, and all of the days that have gone past, they do not have to make up their fasting. If someone dies during the month of Ramadan, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He protects all of us. If they die during the month of Ramadan, then they do not have to make up, and you as a family member do not have to make up for any of their fasting, whether before or after. Some of the ulama have said if they have days before, then you can, from you to make up those days to get some rewards, inshallah. As for travelers, we said because a person must be Muslim, must be sane, must be mature, must be present, resident, and also must be well. So for the travelers, a traveler is allowed to break their fast. This is the consensus of the ulama. All of the ulama have agreed upon this, that a person who is traveling is allowed to break their fast. The difference of opinion is not whether they're traveling or not, it is the distance of the travel. The distance of the travel. Now, to be on the safe side, and we're not going to dive into the debate of travel because it is a big debate, but to be on the safe side, going with all of the madhahib, let us stick to 75 to 85 kilometers. 75 to 85. So if a person has traveled 75 kilometers out of the city, then this is classified as being travel. This is classified as being travel. Even though it is a very strong opinion of the ulama that the word travel is suffice, is enough. As long as you say, I am traveling, then this is enough. And we do not look at the kilometers. Whether it is 50 or 60, whether it is 120, if you are traveling, then they say this is enough. But like I said, to remove ourselves from the debate of the ulama, and to be on the safe side, let us stick to between 75 to 85 kilometers. If you've traveled anywhere in between that or more than that, then you break your fast. We will discuss after what is better, to break the fast or to keep on fasting. But the difference of opinion, like I said, is huge concerning the distance and not the fact, are you allowed to travel or not, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said clearly in the ayah, and if any one of you is ill or traveling, then he should make up the days. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not mention this unless that it is acceptable for the ummah to take on. Also, the ulama are very specific in this, that the travel for them to be able to break their fast must be a travel that is not a travel of sin. Meaning that if you are traveling in the days of Ramadan from here to Queensland to commit a sin, then you are not allowed to break your fast. If you discuss with your friends and then you say, let us go to Queensland because there is a party where there is alcohol and music and women, and you are fasting in New South Wales, you are not allowed to break your fast. And on top of this, you get the sin of participating and traveling to a sin. So the ulama are very, very precise about this. And this is noted by a great number of ulama, that a person to break their fast must be traveling for a halal and acceptable reason. So the traveler is allowed to break his fast according to the consensus of the ummah, whether he is able to continue fasting or not. Whether he is able to continue fasting or not. And whether it is a difficult travel or it's not difficult. Whether you are traveling by camel or by horse, or whether you are traveling by aeroplane, as long as you have passed those distances that I've mentioned, 75 to 85 kilometers, the ulama said, you break your fast. Whether it is what you think to be hardship or not, whether you have an assistant to help you along the way or not, then you are allowed by the consensus of the ulama to break your fast. Now this is also debatable. People who say that today's technology allows us to travel with ease. We have cars with air conditioning, we have cars with cruise control and very comfortable seating, very straight roads and no bumps in the roads. We have aeroplanes and helicopters. We have a lot of ways to travel. We tell them when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this concession, and when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that travel is part of adab, of a punishment, then we must understand that Muhammad ﷺ does not speak of his own accord, rather it is in inspiration of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when he says it is a form of punishment, it is adab upon you, then we take this as it is. And if we travel today, and a lot of you have traveled in an aeroplane, it doesn't matter where you go, when you get to where you are going, you feel tired. You feel tired. Even if you're going for a trip that takes 1 hour from here to Melbourne, and you land in Melbourne, you are tired, physically tired. You are mentally tired. You are emotionally tired because you're in a country, in an area that is not yours. You're in a house or a hotel that is not yours. You are not comfortable with your surroundings. This is adab. And for when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then allows you to pray Dhuhr and Asr together, and pray them two and two, you only know the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you when you travel. And then you say, Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed me to do this. And then you're allowed to also break your fast. Then you say, Alhamdulillah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me this concession, this rukhsah. Because it does affect the body and it does affect the mind. Now, a traveler who is determined to travel in Ramadan should not have the intention of breaking his fast until he actually travels. Meaning, you go to sleep and you say to yourself that tomorrow I am traveling to Melbourne or to Brisbane. When you wake up in the morning, you do not eat and drink as you please. Rather, you make the intention of fasting that day. Then you wake up for suhoor. You eat suhoor. You pray your fajr, you continue fasting, you have this imsak, meaning you don't eat anything, until you either get into your car, and you drive, and you get to outside of the outskirts of the city, then the ulama said, then you can break your fast. Or, you get to the airport, you're in the airport, then they call your name, you go into the aeroplane, as soon as you sit in the aeroplane, and the aeroplane takes off, then you break your fast. Why? Because you do not know what is planned for you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You might have the intention to travel tomorrow, but you wake up in the morning, the flights are cancelled, and alhamdulillah, in Australia, flights are always cancelled. Especially because we always try to go with the cheap airlines, and they always cancel them. Some of them for a day, some of them for 3 months, like Tiger Airlines. So we don't know. And then we have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending some clouds of dust coming from Chile that closes the airport. We don't know. We go to sleep and we wake up the next day, we do not know. So the ulama said to protect your fasting, you make the intention to travel, that's alhamdulillah, this is good, this is for you. But you also make the intention to fast that day. So you wake up for suhoor, you eat your breakfast, you pray fajr, then you prepare yourself for travel. As you would any other time. And until you leave your city, then you break your fast. And even when you break your fast, and it does not happen, for instance, you get to Goulburn, you've broken your fast, then something happens, you have to turn back and come back to Wollongong, then this is okay, the ulama said you continue, that you have broken your fast, but it is best to not eat in public. You do not eat in public in front of anyone. You can eat at home. If you and your family have all broken their fast, you eat at home, because you have to make up that day again anyway. You have to make up that day. If the sun sets and you break your fast on the ground, you go to Sydney Airport, Maghrib has adhan at 5:15, you break your fast with your family, you eat your dates, you drink your water, you get onto the aeroplane, the aeroplane takes off, and all of a sudden you open the window and you see the sun. Do you stop eating? The ulama said no, because you've broken your fast in the place of residence, and the sun had gone down, sunset. When you get into the sky, this is not up to you. The same thing is if you get, and you have bad luck, and you get into the aeroplane, and you're waiting for Maghrib, and the plane is flying, and still no Maghrib. And he continues flying, still no Maghrib. And he might extend for another half hour, 40 minutes. The faster the plane, the worse you will have. You have to, as the Ulama said, you have to wait for Maghrib. Because Maghrib, when you left, hadn't added. You have to wait for Maghrib. And alhamdulillah, nowadays with technology, you can ask the captain when it's sunset, and the captain will tell you when sunsets, wherever they are. Where they're in Perth, whether they're going towards Indonesia, Malaysia, they will tell you when the sun sets. So you have to be diligent. You have to ask. This is your fasting. This could be the difference between accepting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepting this fast from you or rejecting this fast from you. You have to be diligent. Okay, whoever travels to a place and intends to stay there for more than 4 days, according to the consensus of the ulama, then you break your fast during the travel, but as soon as you get to the town or to the village or to the country, you begin fasting again. You travel from here to Indonesia, you broke your fast on the way. As soon as you get to Indonesia, you know you're going to be there for 2 weeks. So you get there, let's say at Maghrib, the next day you have to fast. The next day you fast, because you're going to stay there for more than 2 weeks. There is some debate, there is some difference of opinion, but this inshaAllah is the majority of the mashayikh that we have spoken to and of the four imams that they have mentioned concerning the 4 days and the travelling over 4 days. Even though there is a very strong argument from the other side, but we say we stick to what is inshaAllah safer for the community. If there is more detail that you want, we can inshaAllah go into more detail personally. But this is inshaAllah the safest way. Now, if a traveller passes through a city for more other than his own, he does not have to fast unless he stays there for longer than 4 days. And this is which case he can fast, because the rulings that apply to those who are settled apply also to him. Same thing. And this is mentioned by Fatawa by Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah. A person, and this also happens regularly with some of the brothers and the sisters, a person who always travels. It is part of their job, or part of their education, or part of their life that they constantly travel. A person such as a courier, a taxi, a pilot, a sailor. These people are constantly traveling. Or a uni student that goes to university of Canberra and travels every day, or every second day, or every third day. So these people are constantly traveling. What do? The same applies to the sailor also, who has a home on land. But if a pilot or a sailor has a home where they go, or a sailor has a home inside the ship, he has a room, there's a toilet, he has his wife, his children, everybody. The ulama said that he fasts, because this person is struggling with his house. He doesn't have a house. He's like a nomad. He's like a nomad at the time of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and even to in Australia of the Aboriginals, they were nomads. They will travel with their belongings. They take their tents and they take their caravan and they leave. So if a person constantly travels, then he is not allowed to break his fast or shorten the prayers. This is for the sailor, that he has his house everywhere he goes. But if you are a pilot or a taxi or a courier, then you are allowed to break your fast and shorten your prayers, even if they are long periods of time. But they must make it up after they have stopped and they have came back to their hometown. And this is mentioned by Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. Now if a traveller arrives during the day to where he is going. You've travelled from Australia to Malaysia, and Malaysia is a Muslim country, alhamdulillah, or Indonesia, or you went to an Arab country, or a Muslim country around the world. When you arrived in this country, or even any country in the West, you arrived in the country, and it's still before Maghrib. It's the month of Ramadan, and it's before Maghrib, when you arrived. The ulama said, it is best to abstain from food and drink in front of people, but you are allowed to continue the breaking of your fast, because you have to make up the fast after Ramadan. Now if you start Ramadan in one city, then you travel to another city where the people started Ramadan before you, then he should follow the ruling governing the people where he is. Meaning you started your fast on Sunday in Australia. You went to Indonesia, you're going to spend the rest of Ramadan there, and they started their fasting on Monday. You have to follow the country that you are in. This is mentioned by Sheikh Abdul Aziz bin Baz, rahimahullah, in Fatawa al-Siyam. Okay, the sick. And like I said, we have to be Muslim, we have to be sane, we have to be mature, we have to be resident, and we have to be well. So now if we're sick, in the event of any sickness that makes people feel unwell, a person is allowed to break his fast. The basis of this is the ayah. And if you are sick or you are traveling, then make up the days later. This is going off the ayah and the understanding of the ayah. But if the ailment, the illness, the sickness is minor, such as a minor headache, a cough, then this is no reason to break your fast. So basing on this, the ulama have mentioned, if your illness increases even slightly because of fasting, then you do not fast. If it increases greatly, then it is forbidden for you to fast. Difference. If the sickness increases slightly because of fasting, then it is allowed for you to break your fast. If it increases greatly, then it is obligatory upon you to break your fast. If you have diabetes, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us, and you must take the insulin, or you must take sugar, or you must eat every couple of hours, or you must take a medicine, and the doctors who are Muslim, who know the severity of breaking fast in Ramadan, and they know the importance of Ramadan, tell you that you have to break your fast, then the ulama said, you break your fast. Then you break your fast. So if it is a minor illness, like a small headache, a small fever, a cough, a runny nose, things that do not really affect you because of fasting, then the ulama said, you continue to fast. But if you have a strong fever, and you must take medicine, or you have an influenza, you have a flu, you have a strong flu, then or a headache, a migraine, then the ulama said, you break your fast, and there is no problem with that, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive, and he will also, you will also just make up the day afterwards. Now if there is medical proof, or a person knows from his usual experience, or he is certain that fasting will make his illness worse, and the ulama also said, or delay him getting better. Now the illness might not make you, the fasting might not make your illness worse, but the doctor said, if you fast, then instead of being well in 3 or 4 days, it's going to take you 3 or 4 weeks. Because your body does not have enough energy during fasting to resist this illness. The ulama also said that you are allowed to break your fast. And some of the ulama have even got to the level where it is makruh to fast, because it is disliked to fast if that is the case. Now if fasting causes unconsciousness, he should break his fast and make up the fast on later on. This is Majmu' al-Fatawa have mentioned this. And if a person falls unconscious during the day and recovers before Maghrib or after, his fast is still valid. So as long as he was fasting in the morning and he was unconscious from Fajr until Maghrib, then according to the majority of the scholars, his fast is not valid. Meaning, if you woke up and then you had your suhoor, you prayed Fajr, you had the intention, you were going through the day, and then you fell unconscious for any reason, and then you woke up before Maghrib, and you continued without eating or drinking, the ulama said that this is counted as a day for you. Other ulama have said, no, this is not counted as a day, because for that amount of time you are unconscious, and that time of unconsciousness, there is no fasting for you. And like I said, there are a lot of difference of opinion with the ulama concerning fasting. We are sticking and trying to stick to what is the majority ruling upon these things. Now if a person feels extreme hunger or thirst, and fears that he may die or that some of his faculties, yani some of his body parts, might have irreversible damage. And the fear is not based on your own knowledge. It is based upon science and based upon medicine. He may break his fast and make up for it later on, because saving one's life is obligatory. And this is simple. Islam is very simple. We don't have to think too much. If you are fasting and the hunger and the thirst is so extreme that you feel for your life, then you break your fast. Then you break your fast, because your life is obligatory for you to safeguard. Something that will, inshallah, we don't have exams during Ramadan, alhamdulillah. But students' exams are no excuse for breaking one's fast during Ramadan. And it is not permissible to evade one's parents in breaking the fast because of having an exam. Because there is no obedience to any created being if it involves the disobedience of the Creator. Mentioned by Fatawa al-Lajnah al-Da'imah. There is an exam tomorrow, your parents told you, don't fast tomorrow, you have an exam. I want you to eat and drink in the morning, be very refreshed and energetic for the exam. If the person is a Muslim and he has reached the age of puberty and he's saying, then he says to them, sorry, there is no obedience to you if it means disobeying Allah. What is worse, this is education. This is education. What is worse is that we have brothers and sisters who play sport and they say, Sheikh, tomorrow is our grand final. And I'm fasting, so Ramadan. Can we break our fast? How old are you? You've reached puberty, you're 16, 17 years old. Now you're not allowed to break your fast. Because if you're not allowed to break your fast for any reason concerning medicine, except with proof that this will make it worse, then playing a sport is no excuse. But I'll be really tired. Nobody's telling you to play. But it's our grand final, ya Sheikh. I have to. I've been playing all year just for this grand final. There is no obedience to any other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something that our parents must, and your parents must be very strict with. If a person is over the age of puberty and wants to break their fast for a camp, for an excursion at school, because it's unfair, we're going with the school on an excursion to Darling Harbour, everybody's going to be eating, I'm going to be sitting there fasting. Don't go on the excursion. Tell them, look, stay at home. Relax at home. You're not going to break your fast. You're in year 8, you're in year 9, you've really reached puberty. You have to fast. Yani this is, unless, yani like I said, we'll dive into the traveling. This is a distance. Some of the brothers came to me concerning traveling on a camp. I said, give me the distance. Don't tell me camp. Camp could be next door. You could have camps. When I was growing up, we camped in a place very close. We continued fasting, alhamdulillah, and the teachers accommodated for us. The teachers actually woke us up for Allah's suhoor. And this was Lake Elora High School, not an Islamic school. This is Lake Elora High School. It's a public school. And they woke us up for suhoor, and alhamdulillah, they gave us lesser chores, and we had iftar at Maghrib. But alhamdulillah, they accommodated. If a sick person does not fast in Ramadan, waiting to recover so that he can make up the days later, then he finds out that his sickness is chronic. And chronic sickness means it's not going to leave you. It's going to stay with you forever. He has to feed a poor person for every day that he did not fast. This is from the fatwa of Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah. If a person is fasting in Ramadan, and then he falls ill, then he stops fasting. Then the doctor tells them that this illness is chronic. It's not going to leave you. Then the ulama said, for the days that you have missed and the days that are going to miss, you pay fidya, which you feed a poor person every day one meal. So it's between maybe $7-$8 to $10 in Australia, maybe up to $15 if you want to give them a better feed. So this is what you have to do if your illness is chronic. If a person is waiting to recover from his illness and hopes to get better, but then he dies, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon our souls, then he dies, there is no debt owed to him or his inheritors. If a person's sickness is considered to be chronic, so he does not fast or feed the poor instead, then advances in medical science mean that there is now a cure which he uses to get better, he does not have to make up the fast he has missed because he did not have that at that time. Yani, maybe 5 years ago, this old man, or this old woman, or this person, or this brother or sister had an illness which is chronic. They can't fast. And then he's fed the poor people. He's fed the poor people. And then this year, medical breakthrough, they have a medicine, they have a needle, that if you take it, you are cured from this chronic disease. And you become better. The ulama say you do not have to make up for the days that you have missed, nor do you have to, nor is it obligatory for anybody to pay you back for the money that you paid. Khalas. Whatever happened, happened. Now you start from this year and continue. You start from this year, if the disease now is gone, then you fast as normal from the time that you have received this new medication. If a person is sick, then recovers, and is able to make up the missed fast, but does not do so before he dies or she dies, then money should be taken from his estate to feed the poor person. So now we have a few scenarios. The first is that you are sick, you find out that your illness is chronic, you have to pay poor people for the days that you have missed of Ramadan, you do not have to make up the days. You do not have to make up the days. If you have a chronic disease and you haven't fasted for many years or even one day, and then a cure is developed and you take this medicine and now you can fast, you do not have to make up that day, nor do you have to feed a poor person if there is a cure. So you have to live by that day. That time there was no medicine, now you have the medicine. You have a chronic disease, and then you die after Ramadan without being cured and without being able to pay for the dead or pay for the poor people or make up the days. You do not have to pay that for your inheritance because you had a chronic disease and an illness, and you died before you were able to make up the fast or pay the poor people. But if you have an illness, then you recover after Ramadan, but you do not have the chance to make up the days, and you pass away, your family must take from the estate, from what you have as money, and pay the poor people. So that is for the sick. The elderly. The very elderly who have lost their strength and are getting weaker every day, as of course their end approaches, do not have to fast. And they are allowed not to fast so as long as their fasting would be difficult for them. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said concerning the ayah, interpretation of the meaning, and as for those who can fast with difficulty, that is the old man, they have a choice either to fast or feed a poor person for every day. Surah Al-Baqarah 184. This has not been abrogated. There is no nasakh of this ayah. This ayah continues that this is for the old person or the old man who cannot fast. They should feed a poor person for every day. This is mentioned by Al-Bukhari, Kitab al-Tafsir, Bab Iman. This is concerning that ayah. Because some scholars would have said that this is abrogated when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Shahru Ramadan. That the month of Ramadan, the one that the Quran has been revealed into, the guidance and the separator of truth and evil, if anyone sees this month enters, then you must fast. Some of them said that this verse abrogates. There's nasakh of this previous one. Ibn Abbas said there's no abrogation here, there's no nasakh. This ayah is for the old people who cannot fast. For those who are fighting or fighting an enemy or are being besieged by an enemy, if fasting would make them too weak to fight, they are allowed to break their fast, even if they are not traveling. If they need to break their fast before fighting, they can break their fast. The Prophet ﷺ said to the companions once, before fighting, in the morning you are going to meet your enemy, and not fasting will make you stronger, so do not fast. This is reported by a Muslim. This is also preferred by Sheikh Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. The scholars of Damascus also issued fatwas to the same effect when the city was attacked by the Mongols, the Tatars. If a person's reasons for not fasting is obvious, such as illness, there is nothing wrong with him eating or drinking openly. But if the reason is hidden, such as menstruation, the female period, it is better to eat and drink in secret, as not to attract. For instance, if you see a person, a very old person, in the street in Ramadan, eating or drinking, then this is okay, because this is obvious. It's a very old person, they can't. If a person, their illness is obvious, then they are allowed to eat in public. But if their illness or their reason for breaking their fast is hidden, like the female, no one knows if she is going through her monthly period or not. If you look at her, you don't know whether she's going through her monthly period or not, so she is not allowed to eat and drink in public. So he removes the doubt of the people from her by questioning her intentions and questioning her act of worship. If a person does not know that Ramadan has started until after dawn, after Fajr, he has to stop eating and drinking for the rest of the day, and he has to make up the day later on, according to the majority of the scholars. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, there is no fasting for the one who does not have the intention to fast from the night before, mentioned by Abu Dawud. You go to sleep tonight, we wake up tomorrow, and you have eaten and you've had your breakfast, then you put on the radio or the TV and you hear that the Board of Imams, as Shaykh Abdul Rahman said, the Board of Imams had proclaimed that Ramadan is going to begin today at 2 o'clock in the morning. You didn't know. No fault of your own. You've eaten breakfast already, you have to stop eating. You can't say, I've already broken my fast, I'll continue. No, you stop eating, you have to stop eating. Whether in private or in public, you stop eating, but after Ramadan you have to make up this day. You have to make up this day. When to start and stop fasting. Once the entire disc is formulated, has disappeared, the fasting person should break his fast and not pay any attention to the red glow that remains in the horizon. Sometimes when the sun disappears, the disc disappears, then you still have that reddish glow. We don't pay attention to this. We are looking for the sun setting. And as soon as the sun sets, you can begin to eat. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, once night comes from there and the day disappears from there and the sun has set, the fasting person should break his fast. Reported by Bukhari. The sunnah is to hasten in breaking the fast. The Prophet ﷺ said, or the Prophet ﷺ would not pray Maghrib until he had broken his fast, even if it was only a sip of water, mentioned by Al-Hakim. And Sheikh Al-Albani mentioned it in Silsilat al-Sahiha, Ahadith al-Sahiha. So if the Adhan goes off, because we go off the Adhan, nobody looks at the sun. Very, very, I don't think anybody looks at the sun. We all go off the Adhan all the time. As soon as the Adhan of Maghrib begins, you break your fast. By eating, as we mentioned last week, by eating either fresh dates, or if you don't have fresh dates, then you have dried dates. If you do not have dried dates, then some water. If you do not have water in front of you, then soup or fruit or anything that is halal putting in your mouth, break your fast. Because the Prophet ﷺ used to hasten breaking of the fast. And he said in a hadith, that this ummah, this nation, will stay always in a good state of health, in a good state of being, as so as long as they hasten in their breaking of the fast and prolong their sukuk until the very end. And so this is what we do. And this is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some people, they will wait until the end of the adhan to begin to eat. We tell them that this is not what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted of you, but rather he wanted you to hurry in the breaking of the fast. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would not pray mudr until he had broken his fast, if only with a sip of water. If a fasting person cannot find anything to which he breaks his fast, he should have the intention in his heart to break his fast. You're in your car, the adhan of maghrib has been called, you know by the time that in your heart you have the intention to break your fast. Even if you have no water, you have no dates, your intention is to break your fast. And he should not suck his finger as some of the common people do. Some people, and this is a tradition, a part of culture, if they find nothing, they put the finger in their mouth. They say, because I have to break my fast. How do you break? You gotta eat your finger. There's nothing on your finger. The intention is enough. The intention is enough. Suck on your finger or your thumb. This is not gonna break your fast. He should be aware of breaking the fast before the correct time also, because the Prophet ﷺ saw some people hanging from their hamstrings with blood pouring from the corners of their mouths. And this is in the dream that he saw when he was on a trip with Jibreel ﷺ. And when he asked about them, he was told that these are the people who broke their fast before it was time to do so. And this was mentioned by Khuzaim. Now, if a person is certain or thinks it most likely or is not sure whether he broke the fast before the proper time, he should make up the fast later on. Because the basic principle is that the day is still there and has not ended. Meaning, you're fasting and then you ate something, but then you're not sure. Was it adhan maghrib? What time did I break my fast? Was it at 5:20? Or 5:10? Was it a 5:05? I know the sun was coming down, but did it? If you have this doubt, then the ulama said that after Ramadan you make up this day. Because the basis is, the principle is that the day hasn't finished yet. Until you are certain that it has ended. So until you are certain, you have to make up that day. When the dawn comes, and just concerning this, we say, if a person is certain or if it's concerning the adhan, he should be aware of relying on the word of small children or untrustworthy sources. And he should also be aware of the time differences between different cities and villages when he hears the adhan on the radio and so on. Yani here in Wollongong, if we hear the adhan on the radio, and there is only two or three radio stations that you could hear the adhan on, we have to be aware that this radio is being, where? It's in Sydney. And we're in Wollongong. And the scientists and the meteorologists have said that there is a few minutes between Sydney and Wollongong concerning the adhan of Maghrib and the adhan of Fajr. So we have to be aware of this. Because our basis is not the adhan. Our base is the time of adhan of Maghrib, not the actual adhan, it is the time. Because if this mosque doesn't make adhan of Maghrib until 10 minutes after the time of Maghrib, and I broke my fast at home because of the time of Maghrib, and I come to the mosque and I start making adhan, do I have to make up this day again? No. Because the Maghrib has become, and the night has started. So we do not rely on children who make mistakes. We do not rely on untrustworthy people who never pray. How could you trust this person in telling you the time of Maghrib? He's never prayed in his life. So you have to ask trustworthy people. You have to ask people that you can trust with your siyam, with your day. There's a story that I was told from one of the brothers who lives in Lebanon, in the countryside. True story. And they were all, as we do, we sit on the main table. We sit on the main table waiting for the Adhan Mudrib. So you're sitting, waiting. And in Lebanon, alhamdulillah, you have masajid all over the place. Every second street there is a masjid with them at them. So they're waiting, and all of a sudden they hear a sound. So all he thinks that this is Adhan, begins eating. Starts eating. And his father comes to him, what are you doing? He said, the Adhan. He goes, that wasn't the Adhan, it was a cow. That was a cow of the neighbor, because the cow, when he lets out, this is the difference. You have to be very, very certain of when you break your fast. And if you ever hear a cow, it's very strange, the sound of a cow when it starts to make the noise. It's very distinctive. But if you're waiting for his father, any noise is sufficient. Things that break the fast. Things that break the fast. Now, apart from the menstruation, the hayd for the woman, the monthly period, also nifas, the postnatal bleeding, this what affects the women specifically. Things that can break the fast also are only considered to do so if the following three conditions apply. If a person knows that it breaks the fast, so you have to have knowledge that this breaks your fast, and that he is not ignorant, and if he is unaware of what he is doing and has not forgotten that he or she is fasting, if he does it on his own free will and it is not forced to do it. So if first of all he is ignorant. If a person doesn't know, he's ignorant. He doesn't know that this breaks my fast. He did an action and he says, Wallahi, I did not know that this breaks my fast. He is unaware what he's doing. He doesn't know what he's doing. Or he forgets that he is fasting. And he does it of his own free will and is not forced to do it. Among the things that break the fast are actions that involves the expulsion of the bodily fluids, such as intercourse, vomiting, the period, the menstruation, cupping, hijama, and actions that involve indigesting matter, such as eating and drinking. Now, among the things that break the fast, there are things that are classified as being like eating or drinking, such as taking medicine, pills by the mouth, injections, nourishing substances, or blood transfusions. The asthma puffer, the ulama have said, and this is the Majmu' al-Fatawa concerning the Kuwaiti Majmu' al-Fatawa, they said that the puffer does not break the fast. So if you have asthma and you need to take the puffer, this does not break the fast. So injections that are not given to replace food and drink, but are used to administer medication such as penicillin or insulin or tonics or vaccinations, also do not break the fast. Regardless of whether they are intramuscular or intravenous. And these are two different types, and mashallah we have doctors in the community that can go more onto this. And I give advice to the doctors of our community to be learning and researching these matters, because Muslims are going to come to you to get an injection and they're going to say, doctor, does this invalidate my fasting? You should have enough knowledge to say yes or no. Doctor, I'm going to have this blood transfusion, does this break my fast or not? You should have enough knowledge as a doctor to give them this. Even a dentist should know all of this, because they're not going to ring the sheikh. They're already in your surgery and they need to know. And if they do not know, they are ignorant, you should have enough knowledge and consideration for this Muslim brother or sister to say, sister, if you wait until after Maghrib to take this medicine is better because this is going to break your fast. Maybe she didn't know, maybe he didn't know. So you have the knowledge for this. And this is obligatory upon you as a community member with this task of being a doctor or a dentist. So we ask the doctors and the dentists in our community to please research these masahis, these rulings in fasting. Because the Muslims need this of you. You do not have to go through the salah and the wudu and the... Go through what is specific for now, and then later inshallah you can increase your knowledge more so. So puffers used for asthma also do not break the fast, because it is only compressed gas that goes into the lungs. It is not a food. It is not a food. Having a blood sample taken does not break your fast, and it is permissible because it is something that is needed. This is also mentioned by Sheikh Ibn Baz rahimahullah. Medicines used for gargling do not break the fast, so as long as you do not swallow anything of it. Certain mouthwashes, if you go to the dentist, and that's why we also want the dentist to learn these ahkam. If you go to the dentist and the dentist says you must take this medicine, and it is in the form of a gargling medicine, you put it in your mouth and you gargle it. And to gargle is to move the liquid in your mouth. The same way we make wudu, when we wash our mouth, to gargle. That this does not break the fasting unless it goes down into your throat, into your stomach. And the ulama have been specific. They said if a person has a tooth filled and feels the taste of it in his throat, this also does not break the fast. So when you go to a dentist and you have your filling, and he's going to tell you tomorrow you might taste this filling in your mouth, the ulama have said this does not break your fast. Don't worry about this. As a dentist, as a Muslim, you have to tell this to your patient who is a Muslim, because maybe they don't know. We have some Muslim brothers and sisters who constantly spit in Ramadan. Why? Because they say, I shouldn't swallow my saliva. Who told you this fatwa? Some people do this. You see them always spitting. What are you doing, brother? I'm spitting. I can't swallow my saliva. Why can't you swallow your saliva? No, you're not allowed to break your fast. Who told you this? This is our ummah. We have to educate them. So when you go to the dentist and he's a Muslim, he should tell you. Because when you fix a tooth, please, tomorrow you're going to taste this in your mouth. This does not break your fast. I've asked the ulama, we've asked the mashayikh, you're okay. Continue fasting that day. The following things do not break the fast. Having the ears syringed, nose drops, nasal sprays. So as long as it avoids swallowing anything that reaches the throat. And if you have nasal sprays, and then you can feel it coming down your throat, spit that out. Because that is a foreign body coming into your system, spit it out. Anything inserted into either the vagina or the penis, whether it is fingers or tongs, whether it is, so for instance, a female who's going to have the pap smear, and this is to test for cervical cancer and all the other cancers, and also men who have needles injected into their penis, this does not invalidate the fasting. This does not invalidate the fasting. They're called the IUD, and the doctors will know this, the IUD or the quib. This also does not invalidate fasting. Insertion into the urethra for males or females. The cleansing of the bladder. Some have... They have to cleanse the bladder. And the doctors can explain to this in detail. I don't like going into medical fields. This is not my field. But the cleaning of the bladder also does not invalidate fasting. Dental fillings. This is for the doctors, the dentist. Dental fillings. Tooth extractions. Cleaning of the tooth. Use the siwak or the toothbrush. This does not invalidate fasting. Even if you were to use toothpaste, this does not invalidate fasting unless the toothpaste with the water goes down your throat. And this is where you have to spit it out. But if it does not, then you are allowed. Rinsing, gargling, or applying topical mouth sprays. So as long as one avoids swallowing anything that reaches the throat, this also has to be given. Jazakallah khair. Allah barik. Thank you very much. This once happened in Sydney on the first Jum'ah of Ramadan. The Imam has one of the masajid in Sydney. The Imam has water next to him on the minbar. It stays there every week. They fill it up for him. In Ramadan, the first Jum'ah, he finishes half khutbah, he sits down and he gets the water and starts drinking. And the people that are praying in this masjid, they do not want to embarrass the Imam, nor do they want to attack the Imam by saying, "What are you doing, Yashik?" So alhamdulillah, the brothers down the bottom, they said, "Yashik, it's Ramadan. You guys, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of our deeds." "Yeah, Yashik, you're drinking water in Ramadan." So he had to repent, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a gift. As we mentioned, anyone who drinks or eats in the day of Ramadan, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So continue fasting. Sometimes you forget. You go to the bubbler. I work at a school. So you see the children always in Ramadan, they go to the bubbler, to the tap, and they drink water and they walk away. It's Ramadan, they forget, because the bubbler is right in front of them. Alhamdulillah, I was living in Medina, and in the Haram of Medina, they have the water of Zamzam in all of these big water containers. In Ramadan, they turn the water container, so you have no tap, because you forget, and they get rid of all the cups. There is no cups. This is a blessing. Well, how many times would you enter the Medina mosque and you see in the cup, where the cups, they're exactly like this. They have no cups. They got rid of all the cups. No more cups. And they've turned the whole water around so it faces the wall. So sometimes we need to be reminded during Ramadan also, it doesn't matter if you're the sheikh or the da'iyah or the alim, or even if you're a student at school, you need to be reminded constantly. Also, oxygen. Taking oxygen does not invalidate your fasting. Some people, they have breathing problems, so they need to take oxygen. This does not invalidate your fasting. It is oxygen. All it is doing is giving you more oxygen because you have a problem in breathing. So this does not invalidate your fasting. Also, different types of gases, like the laughing gas that they took you for pain relief, this also does not invalidate fasting. So if you go to hospital, you have a cut, and they need to stitch the cut, they might give you laughing gas. So you can remove this thinking and you can become calm. This does not invalidate your fasting. Medications that the skin absorbs, sun cream, lotions, all of this does not invalidate your fasting. So if you have in the morning, you put some creams on your arms, on your hands, feet, this does not invalidate the fasting also. Also the use of a laparoscope. The doctors would know what that is, a laparoscope. A laparoscope is an instrument inserted through a small incision in the abdomen. Using this also does not invalidate the fasting. Taking samples, biopsies, from the liver or other organs, so as long as the person is accompanied by the administration and the solutions, and there is nothing placed into their system like nourishment, then this also does not invalidate the fasting.
Sheikh, for laparoscopy, you have to be intubated. You have to have a tube in your throat.
The tube.
You are unconscious. And I don't think anyone.
So you're unconscious and the tube is there. Sometimes, can you be conscious?
Yeah, you cannot have a laparoscopy with a conscious person. Oh. They pump gas into the stomach.
Okay, so that is, this is the incision. This is concerning the incision. Yeah. You're a doctor, you know more than me. I don't know. All I'm going off is the fatwa of the ulama. Maybe this is a different country. Allah. So taking biopsies is also okay. External biopsies, this is not a problem. You should be up here, brother. The doctors have to be given this lesson. We should have a lesson every Ramadan by a doctor, not by a sheikh. No, wallahi. Because a doctor has to inform us. We are masakeen, we are weaker people. We need to know what invalidates our fasting. Also, anyone who eats and drinks deliberately during the days of Ramadan, this is the end of what does not invalidate the fasting. This is going into eating and drinking purposefully, deliberately. Anyone who eats and drinks deliberately during the day of Ramadan with no valid excuses has committed a major sin. And is mentioned by the ulama as being one of the kabair. To eat and drink with no reason. This is one of the kabair. And has to repent and make up for that fast later on. If he broke the fast with something which is haram, such as drinking alcohol, then this is not only a major sin, but it is now a major sin with a major sin. And in the month of Ramadan, this person needs to repent. There is no actual punishment. If only the Imam of the Islamic nation, the Khalifa, or the Amir al-Mu'mineen, he has to punish, then it's up to him. But there is no clear punishment for this. But this is a grave sin, and they need to repent. But if he forgets, and as we said before, if you forget and you eat and drink, then let him complete his fast, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has fed him and given him to drink. This is reported by Imam Bukhari, as mentioned by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if you eat and drink by mistake, this is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so continue your fasting, even if it is a meal. Even if it is an entire meal. So you've sat down and you've eaten the entire meal. And you've drank the milk or the drink or the water. And then somebody reminds you or you remember that it is the day of Ramadan. You repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cease eating. You continue fasting. This is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do not have to make up another day. You do not have to make up another day. And this is between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the children, do not use this as an excuse, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what is in your heart more than what you know. So if you want to play this trick and say, I forgot, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows if you really had forgotten or not. Now, if a person sees someone else who is eating because he has forgotten, now you see someone and they are eating or drinking because they have forgotten, he should remind him, because the general meaning of the ayah, وَتَعَاوَنُ عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى, and support one another upon Christ and God fearing. So you support that. You see someone eating in Ramadan, you tell them, brother, it's Ramadan. Say it in a nice way, they will remember. Don't attack them. Don't attack them. God curse, God this, God that. A'udhu billah, what are you doing? This is month of Ramadan. You're a person eating in the streets in front of everybody. You're driving your car. I saw you drinking water. And come in a nice way and tell them, brother, is Ramadan. He might have forgotten, she might have forgotten. And the hadith, if I forgot, remind me. And because of the principle that it is an evil action, munkar, and that you must change it in the best way possible. This is mentioned also by Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah. Those who need to break their fast in order to save someone whose life is in danger may break their fast and should make it up later on. This applies in cases where someone is drowning or when fires need to be put out. You are fasting, it's the days of Ramadan, you see a fire in a house, you jump into the fire, you put out the fire, you had to break your fast. The smoke you breathe in, you have water, you need to drink water, put water over you, so you needed to break your fast to save someone, then you are allowed to do so. Someone is drowning, you do not say, I can't swim, I might swallow some water, this is Ramadan, I can't break my fast. You jump into the water, you save them. If you know how to swim. Don't know how to swim, stay away. You and the person will drown, both of you. But if you are fasting and you can swim, you have to save that person. You have to. It's not a decision to say whether I should or not. It is obligatory upon you. Doesn't matter who the person is. You have to run in and save them, even if you have to break your fast. And if a person is obliged to fast, but he deliberately has intercourse with his wife during the days of Ramadan, with his own free will, and the two genitals have touched, even if they do not have an orgasm or the semen, the cum does not be released, then this is a grave sin. This is a grave sin. He should still fast the rest of the day. He has to stop. Fast the rest of the day. He has to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he has to make the kafara. This is to seek permission, to seek repentance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of the hadith narrated by Abu Hurayra radiallahu anhu, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said when a man came to him and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I am doomed. O Messenger of Allah, I am doomed, halakt. He said, what is the matter with you? He said, I had intercourse with my wife while I was fasting. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do you have a slave whom you can free for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He said, no. He said, can you fast for 2 consecutive months, 60 days in a row? Can you fast it? He said, no. He said, do you have the money to feed 60 poor people? He said, no. The same ruling also applies in the case of zina, adultery, fornication, homosexuality, and bestiality. So he said, no. The ruling of ulama is that if you have a slave, and nobody has a slave nowadays, but that's where we start. This is in order. This is not to choose. Don't look at it and choose and say, look, I have a slave, I'll free a slave. Or, you know, freeing a slave, I need this slave. I'll fast for 60 days. Or fasting 60 days, this is too much energy. I, alhamdulillah, a lot of money. I'll just pay for the 60 people to be fed. No, no, the ulama said, this is in order. You cannot pick and choose. Because if you can pick and choose, then the severity of the sin has disappeared. And of the punishment has disappeared. If you don't have a slave, then you have to fast the 60 days. There is not a person on the face of the earth today that can tell me they cannot fast 60 days unless they have a medical issue. You have a medical issue, then you can say, I can't fast the 60 days. You do not, then for the punishment and for this grave sin of having intercourse with your wife during the days of Ramadan, you have to fast the 60 days. Don't tell me I want to pay the 60 fidya. So 600, how many? 30 times 10 is 300. So $600. The majority of us, they'll say $600, not a problem. Every day, 600, 600, 600, work it out, as long as I can still be with my wife. Some people, they said, if I have a lot of money, millions of dollars. But Islam did not say this. Islam said, you fast 60 days, no choice. When you cannot, the man said he can't, physically he cannot, he is ill, he cannot fast 60 days, then you pay for the 60 people. Now if a person has intercourse during the day on more than one day during Ramadan, then he must fast the 60 days for each day. And I recommend a person like this to have a holiday, leave his wife and go to the village and sit by himself. If for the first time he can't hold yourself, the second time there's a mushkil, there's a problem. There's 60 days of fasting here. 60 days. This is a problem. Leave. Leave your wife and say, I'll see you in 30 days. I'm doing i'tikaf in the masjid, don't come in. In the masjid, stay in the masjid, because alhamdulillah, no good. This is a problem. Yani, Islam has come here and fasting is there to instill some kind of worship in you, that you may control your lust and desire. Now, this is the trickery of the Yahud, of the Jewish people, as some of the ulama would say. If you want to have intercourse with your wife and you know that that will cost you 60 days of fasting, so what do? You go drink some water. You break your fast, drinking water. I've broken my fast, I've drank water. Then you go have intercourse with your wife, so you get out of the 60 days, you only make the day, the one day, for breaking your fast. This is trickery of the Yahud. This is the trickery of the Yahud. This is what the Yahud do. The Jews were told, ordered by God, not to fish during the Sabbath, on the Saturday. So they put their nets out on the Friday, and they collect them on the Sunday morning. We didn't do anything. The women were ordered, the Jewish women were ordered to cover their hair like the Muslims. And like the Christians. That's why you have the Christians, they cover their hair, the women. If you go to some areas like Greece, like Italy, like Spain, and you see Christian women, they cover themselves. And the nuns in every other country, they cover themselves. The Jews were also ordered to cover themselves. What do the women do? They buy wigs. They're all wearing wigs. You look at them, it's normal hair, but they're all wearing wigs. And this is a part. If you go to the Jews of Bondi and the Jews of Melbourne, you see all of them, they have beautiful long hair. They're all their wigs. And this, there was a documentary on ABC about this. She has many wigs. For every day, for every occasion. You think it's her hair, but it's not. Because she's fundamental Jewish. She has to cover her hair. But the trickery of the Jews, they wear a wig. So a Muslim, he wants to be this trickery. I want to have intercourse with my wife. I drink some water. I do one day after Ramadan. I finish. No problem. The ulama have said, if a man wants to have intercourse with his wife, but he breaks his fast by eating first, his sin is more serious. Because he's violated the sanctity of the month on two accounts. By eating, by having intercourse. Even if he's more certain in the case that he can make up the days, is obligatory. If he tries to get out of it, that only makes matters worse. He must repent sincerely, and this is majmu' al-fatawa, and some of the ulama have said, he still has to fast the 60 days. And this is trickery. And if we had the khilafah, there will be more than the 60 days. And this is, you're trying to trick Islam. It's not, you do not make Islam into a fool in front of you. You can play games with the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, what about kissing and hugging and embracing and touching your wife? Are you allowed? Yes, you are. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned by Aisha, she said that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi used to kiss his wives during the days of Ramadan. But she also mentioned that he had more control over his lust and desire, over his desire, sorry, than any one of you. And if you have control, and you can kiss your wife and go to work, you kiss your wife when you come home, yani, you hug her before you go to your work, this is not a problem, you're sitting, you're discussing things and she's in your lap and you're hugging her, this is okay. But if you cannot control yourself, then do not do this. No kissing, no hugging, no anything. Stay away from this. If the person is engaged in an act of intercourse and the dawn comes, Salat al-Fajr, he is obliged to withdraw. And his fast will be valid. Yani, you are in the process of intercourse, and the Adhan al-Fajr has been called, or the time of Fajr has entered, you have to stop, have ghusl, and your fasting is accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If morning comes and the person is in the state of janaba, impurity following sexual intercourse, this does not affect his fasting. If a person at the night has intercourse and goes to sleep, he has janaba, this is sexual impurities, he doesn't wake up for Fajr, he slept in, there was any reason. And he wakes up after Fajr, after the Adhan of Fajr, and he is still impure, this does not affect his fasting. He makes ghusl and continues the day. This does not affect the fasting. If a person who is fasting sleeps and experiences a wet dream, this does not break his fast according to the scholars' consensus, the Ijma' al-Muslimin. You go to sleep during Dhuhr or Asr, you wake up with a wet dream and you have released the money. The ulama, the Ijma' have said, this does not break your fast. If a person ejaculates during the day in Ramadan because of something that he could have refrained from, such as touching a woman repeatedly or touching himself repeatedly, then he must make up that day again, and he has broken his fast. He has broken his fast. If he is in control and he releases this, he must make up the fast. Whoever vomits unintentionally, you vomit unintentionally does not have to make up the fast later on, but whoever vomits on purpose has to make up the fast. This is mentioned by Imam Tirmidhi. A person who vomits deliberately by sticking his finger down their throat or applying pressure to the stomach, or deliberately smelling a repulsive odor, or looking at something that could make him or her vomit, is obliged to make up that fast later on, but they still have to continue fasting that day. Because you are in control. But if you, for any reason, uncontrollably, you're driving, and then you feel car sick and you start to vomit, it is not from you, then you continue fasting. If you are driving and you see a car accident, and there is something disgusting that you have seen, something that is repulsive, a body, blood, and you vomit, this is not from you. But if you deliberately do it, then you have to make up that fast after Ramadan. If a person unintentionally swallows something that is stuck between his teeth, or it is in a so small that he could not tell whether there was it was from the spit or not, then he does not break his fast. Yani, you have things between your teeth after you eat, of course. And it stays in your teeth. And you feel something go under, but you're not sure, is that part of my spit or it wasn't part of the spit? The ulama said, because it's a small thing, this is not counted. You can continue your fast. If a person suffers from a nosebleed, his fast is still valid, because this is something beyond his control. If your nose starts to bleed uncontrollably, then this does not affect your fasting at all. If his gums bleed after using the siwak, it is not permissible for him to swallow the blood. If you are using your toothbrush or siwak and your gums start to bleed, you are not allowed to swallow the blood. You have to spit it out. However, if some blood enters his throat by accident and he did not mean for it to happen, there is no need to worry and he does not have to refast that day. This is the main aspects of the fast. I'm not sure of time. We are half past eight. We have gone for a while. I'll just very quickly go through a few more points. Using the siwak is sunnah. The siwak is the stick of al-araq. This stick is found in many countries. It is popular in Saudi Arabia, and it is allowed to be used. Also the toothbrush. Also the toothbrush. You're allowed to use your toothbrush to clean your teeth during Ramadan. But the siwak is sunnah. So the siwak, you get two rewards, for cleaning your teeth and using something that the Prophet ﷺ asked you to use. Also, smoking breaks the fast, and it cannot be used as an excuse not to fast also. So a person who smokes, this breaks your fast. And if you smoke and you say you cannot quit smoking, this is not an excuse for you not to fast. You have to fast. Do not use this sin, which smoking is a sin, then you do not use it as a reason for you not to fast. Immersing oneself in water or wrapping oneself in wet clothes in order to cool down does not break your fast. Yeah, and going for a swim does not break your fast. Putting yourself in the tub because it is a very hot weather does not break your fast. And we won't have any of these issues inshallah this Ramadan, it is very cold. So doing this does not break your fast. Unless water enters your throat and then of course goes to your stomach. If a person eats and drinks and is having intercourse thinking that it is still night, and then he realizes that dawn has already broken, there is no harm done, because the ayah clearly states that it is permissible to do these things until one is sure of the dawn. Abdul Razzaq reported with a sahih isnad going back to Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu that he said, Allah has permitted you to eat and drink so as long as there is any doubt in your mind. Shaykh al-Islam continued, If a person breaks his fast thinking that the sun has already set, when it has not, he must make up the fast later on, according to the majority of the scholars, because the principle is that there still is day until certainty comes that the day has finished. It is the opposite. When you're eating and drinking, this does not affect your fasting until you are certain that day has begun through the true dawn. But when you are fasting, you are not allowed to fast, to break your fast, unless you are certain that the day has ended. See the difference? So if you continue eating after the dawn, thinking that it's still night, then this is accepted and you can continue your fasting. But if you eat before sunset, thinking that it's sunsetted already, you have to make up that day, because you should have continued your fasting until you are certain that the day has ended. See the difference? If the dawn breaks and a person has food or drink in his mouth, the fuqaha are agreed that he should spit it out and his fast is valid. If he spits it out, his fast is valid. This is like the ruling of one who eats or drinks because he forgets, then remembers he is fasting. If he hastens to spit it out, the food or drink in his mouth, his fast is still valid. Even though some of the ulama, and this has a strong proof also, that if you have water in your mouth, then you continue drinking it until the water has finished. This is the majority of the rulings. There are a lot more rulings, but this is a great number of rulings. I don't want to go for too long. Just one or two more rulings for the women, especially for the women, and then we'll end it. And then if you do have any questions, we will try our best to answer those questions, inshallah. Now, if a woman is menstruating, when a woman, menstruating woman sees the white substance, this is for the women, they understand what I'm saying, which is discharged by the uterus when the period finishes, by which a woman knows that she has now become tahir, pure, she should have the intention to fast from the night before, and she should fast. If she does not have a time when she knows she is tahir, pure, she should insert a piece of cotton or something similar, and today they have, of course, the pads, the cotton which they use. And if it comes out clean, then she should fast, and she should, if she starts to bleed again, she just stops fasting, whether the blood is a flow or just spotting, because it breaks the fast as long as it comes at the time of the period. So if this is your days of the period, which is 5, 6, 7 days, the common days of period, and you think that you have stopped, then you put a pad and it is clean, and you know that you could be clean, so then you make your ghusl and you start fasting. And even the ghusl is not compulsory for you to begin fasting, but it is compulsory for you to pray, of course. But then if blood comes out again, then you stop again. Then you stop. So if the blood stops for 1 hour, 2 hours, then you make the intention to fast. But then if the blood comes out again, then you cease your fasting. If a woman's period or postnatal bleeding ceases during the night and she makes the intention to fast, but dawn comes before she is able to do ghusl, according to the scholars, her fast is valid. She wakes up in the middle of the night, she feels that she is clean, but she hasn't made ghusl yet. She wakes up and she hasn't made ghusl yet, and the adhan of fajr has been called, then her fasting is valid. She makes ghusl and prays fajr. There is no problem with this. If a woman knows that her period will come tomorrow, she can feel it, and women can feel this, that her period is tomorrow or it is tonight, it is very close, she should still continue her intention to fast. And she should not break her fast until she sees the blood. Very simple. There's no blood, you have feelings, you continue to fast. When you see the blood, you stop your fasting. It is better for a menstruating woman to remain natural and accept what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed and do not take medicine. Some women, they take medicine for their period, their menstrual cycle to stop during the month of Ramadan. It is better and there is more reward if a woman stays on her natural state, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created her, and then break her fast when she sees blood, and then continues fasting after that, then makes up her days later on. If a pregnant woman miscarriages and the fetus is formed or has an outline of any body, such as the head or a hand, then her blood is nifas, meaning she continues to break her fast for the 40 days. But if, however, she passes something that looks like a blood clot, al-alaq, or a chewed piece of meat, yani just a piece of meat comes out, there is no human resemblance, it doesn't look like a head, there is no feet, there is no arms, yani it's still in its very, very early stages of pregnancy, then this will be istihara, meaning this is the extra blood that comes out, and when she stops, when the blood stops, then she continues her fasting. The scholar stated that the embryo is considered to start taking shape after 80 days of pregnancy. So before 80 days, the ulama said you classify this as istihada, you classify the first 7 days as being your period, and after that, you continue fasting. If a breastfeeding woman fasts during the day and sees a spot of blood during the night, although she was clean during the day, her fast is still valid. If a breastfeeding woman, because it's different with a breastfeeding woman. If a breastfeeding woman also, the doctors have told her that if she fasts, affects her milk, it will cease the milk or it will decrease the amount of milk and this will affect the child, the ulama said that she does not break her fast. That she breaks her fast. If it affects the milk, then she breaks her fast. If she is pregnant and fasting affects the child or the mother, then she breaks the fast. And this has to be told again, our doctors. The Muslim doctors are the ones that make this decision, not the mother, unless she's a doctor. The mother cannot make this decision, she won't know. But when she has her test with the doctor says, if you fast, this will affect your embryo, affect your child. Then she is not allowed to fast. If it affects her health, then she does not fast. If she is breastfeeding, and the doctor says that breastfeeding and fasting won't be good for you, so you have to stop fasting, so you stop fasting. And this is the wisdom in Islam, that we care. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to fast, but He also has mercy upon you and your child, and you continue to break your fast until it is safe for you and your child. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He blesses us with the understanding of Siyam, that He blesses us with the understanding of His deen. We hope that we have conveyed the majority of your questions, but I know that Ramadan always has questions. And Ramadan always has personal questions that maybe they have thought and you have experienced and you need to know the answer. We could help you as best we could. If there is no question now and you remember a question, you can go to plenty of internet sites that are reliable to take from them their answers. But you make sure that they are reliable from reliable sources. They are reliable from reliable sources on the internet. If not, you have Sheikh Abdul Rahman and you have myself, if you can talk to me. You have plenty of mashayikh in Sydney and in Australia and mashayikh around the world. Call them. This is the month that knowledge is compulsory upon you to gain. The same way that you had to gain all knowledge according to salah and wudu to be able to pray 5 times a day, then you have to gain as much knowledge about siyam. Because you are a Muslim living in a Muslim society here in this masjid, there is no excuse for you to say, I don't know. There's plenty of means for you to find out. Do not say after, Allah, I didn't know. So inshallah, we gain knowledge. And as I said, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He blesses us in this month and He allows this month to be used for us, Yawm al-Qiyamah, and not used against us, Yawm al-Qiyamah. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I apologize for the extended lesson, but we didn't want to go into a third week. Let us leave it 2 weeks, inshallah, is enough.